Welcome to Raging Bullets, a DC Comics fan podcast, episode 512. We talk the Justice League movie. Welcome to Raging Bullets. I'm Sean Whalen, Dr. Norge. I'm joined as always by my co-host Jim, the sensei of the whatnot, Segulin, the Duke of you know, and of course, the recently resurrected elder statesman of the podcast.
How's it going, eh?
Mother Box!
Thank you.
Jim, on this episode, we're going to be talking about the recently released Justice League movie. It's all spoilery, so glad you guys could join us for this one. We are proud members of the Comics Podcast Network, the League of Comic Book Podcasts, and the InfiniteComics.com podcast partnership. Mr. Segan, we are sponsored as always by DCB Service and InStockTrades.com. What is going on at DCBService.com?
Well, of course, we have our bundles, which they continue to support the DC universe, so thank you for those. But also, you know what? We have a great Superman celebration of 75 years hardcover, 50% off, only $19.99. 50% off of that one. Okay. Also 50% off. We have Superman Action Comics Deluxe Edition, Mr. Oz hardcover rebirth story. This is again, two really cool Superman stories, 50% off. Thank you. Thank you, DCBS.
I want to remind everyone they're a digital partner, whether you do Comixology or My Digital Comics, you want to link those accounts to your DCB service account. Earn 5% of those purchases towards your DCB service order. Remember, you want to shop through their portal. So you go to their website, you'll see from the drop-down digital comics, you click on those links, go in there. Once you've linked your accounts, they'll automatically generate into your DCB service account. Doesn't cost you anything more. It does help our show sponsor out, and DCB service sponsors a wide variety of podcasts. So please consider doing that. Over at InStockTrades.com, we're Justice League happy. So let's talk about some of the latest releases. The Flash Volume 4, Running Scared trade paperback, 45% off, only $8.24. Legend of Wonder Woman Origins trade paperback, 45% off, only $10.99. Wonder Woman trade paperback, Volume 4, God Watch, 45% off, only $9.34. If you've been missing any of your trade paperback collections or hardcovers, you want to go to InStockTrades.com and pick them up, and I want to thank them for continuing to support our show. Mr. Segulin, what kind of a podcast are we?
Raging Bullets is a spoiler podcast. We go in-depth into plotline, story twists, and whatnot of the Justice League movie. So if you haven't watched the movie, hit pause, go to the movie theater, watch it. You will enjoy it. Highly suggest going with the 3D because that looked really cool. And then you come back and you listen. That way you can better enjoy the show.
I would even suggest seeing it a second time.
Ooh, yes.
But that's just me. Let's talk the movie.
Hope this craft can withstand this powerful force.
All right, Jim, so we just had Justice League Week, which I walked in. You heard me on the last episode talking about what some of my tentative pieces were, and there were two characters really that stood out for me as being tentative, Aquaman and The Flash. The Flash, obviously because of the TV show. I'm a huge fan of the TV show, so I've got Grant Gustin in my mind, and his portrayal of The Flash is a thing. Aquaman, just because what I had seen from the trailers gave me kind of an impression that he was going to be more this brutish guy. I'll talk specifically about those characters as we get into this discussion and talk deeply about them, and really everybody who was in this film. Initial impressions were, I walked in, I don't want to say I walked in tentative, I didn't, I was excited. I was really pumped to see this film. Wonder Woman was a huge success for me, I really enjoyed that. I was a fan of Batman v Superman, so the idea of continuing where the ending of that film left us was exciting for me. And so I felt like DC was heading in the right direction. Walking into this movie, I walked in a little, you know, worried about those two characters, but overall super excited. I had so much fun with this film. I know that it'd gone through rewrites and, you know, changes and things like that. I honestly, what's important about a film is the way that it transports you in that time and makes you smile. I can clearly see from this film that there was probably two different movies at play here at one point. But so, I mean, if it was funny, I was chatting back and forth with a friend of mine from work saying, what grade would you give it? I said, I'd give it a high B, But I really, I mean, as far as overall enjoyment, this is one of those, I can tell you right now, this automatically is going in my rewatch list. And it's not because of some DC, I've got a lot of DC movies. I don't rewatch all of them over and over again. This one I will, because it captured for me the essence of what I love about these characters. Was it perfect and flawless? No. Was it a load of fun? Yes. And I think that's something that Wonder Woman brought back in her movie that I think this film captured in a way that now I can look back objectively at Batman v Superman and go, what was missing from that? This. And I feel like this film benefited from where Batman v Superman left us, in the sense that I wanted to see this. I wanted to see the yes moments out of this that it gave me. So I feel like my enjoyment of this film, it's important to say, I had a blast with this. And it really comes from the journey of Man of Steel, Batman v Superman, Wonder Woman, to where we're at right now. I feel like we're heading in a really strong positive direction of people who are aggressively understanding the DC characters. I've seen it twice now. I loved it the second time even more than the first, which says a lot. I didn't walk in, you know, kind of like, oh, all right, I've kind of seen this scene. I honestly felt because I didn't have the baggage of what I was walking in worried about. I just went in and had a good time on the second viewing and really loved this film. That's where I'm at, though. I'm curious, where are you on this? Because we kind of texted back and forth, but we know we're recording something. We don't go into detail. So where are you at?
I think for the first time in us doing this show, I'm giving a movie a higher grade than you are.
Cool.
Yeah, I think that I'm trying to remember any time when we had talked about a movie or TV show where, because you are a little more, you know, you're a little bit more positive in your gradings than I am. And mm-hmm. with me, I'm actually giving this a solid A. You know, it's cool. I absolutely love this movie. And, you know, I've seen it twice now. I'm already planning my third. I was trying to figure out a way I could catch it in IMAX just because, you know, I saw it in the 3D. I was like, and I really couldn't get the timing in yesterday from, you know, to catch the IMAX show. You know, so I was like, okay, so now I'm looking at during the week, I'm going to go again, you know, just because I want to see this multiple times. I had an absolute ball with this movie. And I think for me, it was the fun aspect of a superhero movie that I've been missing in DC. DC, a lot of times, has done movies where they do a real movie where the characters happen to be superheroes, you know, and it's not just that big fun movie of, you know, Superman punching big robots. You know, you have Superman having life experiences and what he's dealing with being Superman and this and that. And they sometimes miss the parts where we want to see him fly in and just beat the crud out of people and do stuff that only Superman can do. This movie captured all of those elements. This movie had those, you know, really cool, deep moments between, you know, Bruce and Diana, where they're talking about, you know, basically the nature of being a leader and what it takes to be that leader. But it also had comical moments of the Flash and Aquaman gave some funny moments. And even Batman had some times when I was laughing. You know, actually, every single character in this movie had at least one point in time that had me laughing out loud. You know, I can think of every, you know, whether it's my toes hurt. I can't even imagine the physics behind my toes hurting. I laughed out loud with that one in Cyborg. And, you know, and just everybody's just the general fun and humor and joking. But it never took away from the serious impact of we may actually lose the world here. We got to band together. And I think for me, that was that overwhelming team idea, that overwhelming humor, as well as, you know, seriousness, as well as just generally cool superhero moments, is what I absolutely loved about this movie. And second time I laughed even more because there was some stuff that, you know, when you're watching it the first time, I'm focused on what's happening. That second time was just pure enjoyment for me, and I'm laughing out loud. And the theater around me, we had some really, you know, the second showing, I think I had a better crowd of people because we were laughing and clapping and stuff like that. So it's interesting that, you know, the more I get it, the more I'm watching it, the more I'm getting into it.
I agree. And honestly, the fun part that you're talking about is, I think, what I enjoyed so much more about this film and why I link it more to Wonder Woman than Batman v Superman. It's interesting for me that I look at this as a journey, an ongoing journey. Like, I want to see, you know, the second, we're going to be jumping all over the place, but the second preview where they're talking about, I saw some people like bashing the fact that Deathstroke was in the, there wasn't anybody like Darkseid or somebody big in that second one. I don't know. I like the idea of doing an Injustice Society or Legion of Doom, whatever the heck they're going to do in the next film, if that's where they're going with this, just because there's a lot of characters you can bring in, and I want to see this team be able to interact with them and be able to work together in various configurations, because I think this film benefited from the buddying up that was going on here. You mentioned Batman, Wonder Woman. Let's just start with those two characters, because they really were our linchpins at the beginning, because they were seeking out the others for the purpose of putting a band together of any sort, because they knew what was coming. And I really liked that through their growing relationship, we got Ben Affleck's Batman. I really liked in this. It's not that I didn't like him in Batman v Superman, but the movie was dark. So you didn't get a chance to see all of the facets of Batman. We got to see more of Alfred. Alfred, I really want to see a solo Batman film, because I feel like there's something interesting ready to go on with Alfred and Commissioner Gordon. I felt like it was great that they were in this. I really enjoyed the sense of the fleshing out of the universe, but they haven't benefited from what Lois Lane has and Martha Kent has from being in a full-blown movie that was a little more focused on their world. And I want to see that, because Ben Affleck's Batman, I really, really liked in this. I liked that this movie showed the Wonder Woman that we got in the solo film. Not that she wasn't there in Batman v Superman, but because she came in the middle of the fight and there was that mystery around her, we didn't really get, you know, in the earlier part of the film, we didn't really get to dive deep into the character. Now that we have, I feel like there's just been a story progression with her that is really apparent here and built in the relationship between the two that I really liked, like, I'm going to go on the sequence where after Superman had hit him and she like recognized how beat up he, the compassion you see from her, the warrior going and you can't keep this up forever. And, you know, there was such a nice banter that was never slapstick. It was funny, but it was also endearing. And there was so much of that throughout this film of a wide variety of emotions that felt natural for these characters. So when I'm giving it the grade that I am, I want to be careful to say that I am giving it a high B because I feel like there were A-plus moments throughout the film. And that's one of them that I just spoke about. Yeah. I feel like because the film had the issues of the rewrites and things like that, that I'm hoping there's like an extra like director's cut or something of this with extra footage, because I'd like to see more of it, because I feel like this was so on the cusp of being an A-plus movie. And if it sounds like I'm being critical of the movie, I'm not. I loved it. This is going to be a rewatch over and over again. I'm completely in your place on I want to see it in IMAX. I want to see it again. I saw it twice and like my momentum hasn't stopped with this. I'm more just kind of, you know, did you think this is a perfect movie? No. Did I have an absolute blast with it? Yeah, there's a lot of movies that I think are A-movies that I never want to see again. This one I can't wait to see again. Yeah. I'm salivating to see it again. So it's different. It's more, I'm grading it as a film kind of separately than I'm grading what my, if you ask me what my enjoyment factor was for the whole thing, that was an A. So, I mean, I guess that's different than grading the movie itself.
Yeah, and it's, you know, I tell you, with the Batman and Wonder Woman sequences, absolutely love them. Batman, any of the, everything you were saying, I was nodding my head along with you, because Alfred, Jim Gordon, you know, I want to see more of their interactions. I want to see more. Ben Affleck as Batman was outstanding, simply outstanding. I know there's going to be people who hate him. They hated it when he first announced him. When Batman versus Superman, I was like, okay, he's okay. I wasn't, you know, super salivating, gung-ho, yay, Ben Affleck. But I'll tell you, by this movie, I'm loving this because we got to see more of him as Batman, but him as Bruce Wayne. And you got to see the real person, his interactions with Alfred, his interactions with Diana, in and out of the cowl. You know, you got to see some. I love the little Gordon bits between the two of them. They gave you a nice taste that these two have that respect and friendship that we love in the comic books. They gave us a little taste of it because there wasn't a lot of time to show it, you know. And, you know, again, a solo movie, we'd get a better chance to have a more interaction between those two. More time in a solo movie, the Alfred and Bruce interaction and their, you know, developments and family and whatnot. So I'm so excited. I hope, you know, the next solo Batman? Because I heard some rumors said they're going to do an earlier one, so they'll do a different actor. No, they're going to do Ben Affleck. And I keep hearing different rumors. I don't know what the truth is. Personally, I hope we get a solo Ben Affleck movie because I do like him as Batman and Bruce Wayne. And that's the key. If a Batman movie, you got to like the Batman the way he's written. And for me, this again, there were these moments of I laughed when Bruce and Diana were talking about the leadership and all that. And I first thought that popped in my head is, hey, wow, Wonder Woman's a reluctant leader. I did laugh when I thought that. And it was a weird time to laugh in a movie theater when they're talking, you know, between Bruce and Diana. But I do like the fact that in this movie, we have a Batman acknowledge that somebody else should lead the team. You know, not only Diana, but he also says Clark should have been there. He's like, Clark's more human than I am. And I love that moment where this is an older Batman. This is an older Bruce Wayne
who
recognizes.
So you're saying in this movie that both Batman and Wonder Woman justified that Superman should be part of the leadership?
Yes. Yeah.
I'm only joking. I honestly liked... To your point, actually, it kind of validates some of the reluctant leader stuff you've said in the past. I really liked her debate on that, and I think Superman would agree with a lot of it. And I think that's an interesting thing about leaders in these superhero movies. You don't often get this discussion over the danger you put people at. Because this team was green. I mean, you know, you're dealing with the Flash and Cyborg, who are completely brand new to this experience. Aquaman. You know, at some point, it flat out under Lasso admitted that he was scared. And I'm going to say this. Aquaman was one of the characters. I was kind of teetering on this in the last episode when I was talking about it because I love the actor. I absolutely adore him. So I wasn't worried about him. I knew I would find him kick butt. I wanted to see the layers of depth that I did see in this film. There's so much potential for an Aquaman movie that spun out of this. I am super excited for Aquaman. Like, Aquaman solo film, tomorrow, please. Yes. After this film. And this is what I was hoping for. I was hoping to be smacked in the face. There were rumors of them, like, trying to link him more closely to Wonder Woman and stuff like that. I liked the way they handled the Atlanteans and the Amazons in this, as far as creating a longer mythos. But I liked that Aquaman totally felt like, I really don't want to use the fish out of water pun. But you know, he's still a man between two worlds. He's got the pressures of Atlantis, which they started to address in this, and the pressures of trying to be a part of human society. So it was interesting. I want to see more of the character. I want to see the interior guy that we got to see some of in this. That I'm like, okay, I can believe this. I can get behind this. I can get behind this guy being Aquaman and what he's going to do. And the layers. There's some opportunities here I thought that were great. I would have liked to have seen more with him with Mira. And it's very clear that they don't have a relationship other than that she's aware of who he is. So I didn't get a sense of chemistry between the two of them, but I want that. I want to see a development in that relationship. It wouldn't have been appropriate in this film. She was more of a cameo,
a setup for his solo movie.
Yes, which was great. And yeah. That's not a criticism at all. I liked it the same way when we saw him in Batman v Superman. This is kind of like how I took Mira in this one. He was great, though. And as far as, do I want to see that character in a solo film? Absolutely, I do. I was pleasantly surprised at how much depth they were able to give him in this film, considering the fact that this was really an introduction to him, and we haven't seen his whole backstory yet.
Yeah, for me, with him, going into the movie, I was, like, excited for him, just because I knew we were going to get this butt-kicking, warrior. And, yes. And that was something I was very happy for. And then we had these glimpses of the deeper man behind him, the man that could be king of Atlantis. We got just little tastes and little tweaks of it. Granted, a lot of it was under the lasso. So that was, it made it a comical scene, but it also kind of delved a little bit into his soul. But it did show his step up and his responsibility when he started seeing, when the mother box got stolen from Atlantis, he's like, okay, I'm in now, but I'm going to need some stuff. And he armors up, and it's part of, you know, kind of a development of the character. You know, this for me was kind of how Batman versus Superman was our introduction to Wonder Woman, which got us excited for her solo movie. This was our introduction of Aquaman, which has me completely excited for the solo movie, because that's where we're going to see the development of Aquaman. We're going to see, I'm assuming we're going to see the development of the King of Atlantis. Right now, he's not Atlantean. He is, but he's not, you know, part of the Atlantean life, the nobility, the royalty, any of that stuff. I'm assuming his solo movie is going to be him assuming the throne and him defending and fighting for Atlantis. And maybe it'll be the introduction of Black Manta. You know, maybe it'll be, I don't know, any possibilities that could come down the line. So again, great introduction for him. Great, you know, setup for his solo movie. I'm excited for it. I want to see his and Mira's relationship develop, because, as you said, I completely agree. They really, you know, he doesn't even really know her. You know, so this is going to be his solo is going to be their development, their relationship. So you know, there's so much to look forward to in the Aquaman solo that I'm like, okay, let's do this. You know, for me, he brought that right amount of comedy and action that a really cool superhero movie needs. And that was one of those moments, the big giant fight sequence, the ending final fight sequence, is just seeing him have a ball riding a parademon down through a building going, yeah, all right. Like I cheered both times I saw the movie, even though that's a scene from the trailers. So I knew it was going to happen. Still seeing it on the big screen had me cheering.
Here's why. And it's context. The relationship with him and Cyborg, how there was that friction, heavy friction between the two of them. And then in that sequence, Cyborg caught him, and he's like, your ride's not over yet. And he's like, my man. And, and he threw him in, and you got to see those great moments. I think the scene where he first won me over, and it wasn't that I didn't like him beforehand. I loved the character beforehand. But the scene where I started to feel the regal king part of him, you know, the potential for that, when Steppenwolf opened up that hole and the water started rushing in Gotham, and he came through and he slammed down that trident and was holding the water back, there was something powerful, majestic, and regal in that moment of him just instinctually taking like that leadership role of, I am going to do everything I can to make sure these people are safe. And it was kind of the bit that Bruce was calling him out on earlier in the film. When, you know, Bruce was saying, but you're saving the people here, you know, and you know, calling him on some of the contradictions of things that he was saying versus what he was doing. And I really liked the humanity of all of these characters and their interactions. I really felt like as I got to know them more, I got much more excited about knowing who they were and how they're being used in this universe. And that was universal. Whereas, you know, in Batman v Superman, it was, you know, seeing these two characters that I love so much, like, do horrible things to each other. And for a purpose. And we knew where that storyline was going. But Wonder Woman coming in and being this light that I'm talking about, this film was filled with that discovery with every single team member of Justice League, even the established ones. And that was something I really enjoyed. So Aquaman I'm like, in that moment, I'm like, wow, that is sweet. I want to see more of this guy and what he's doing. The costume really grew on me. I was not a fan of the armor in the first time I saw it, just because I think I wasn't noticing the gold on the top and the A. It looked like it was one big green suit, I guess, in other shots that I'd seen. So I wasn't super excited about it. I saw what they did in this one, and I'm like, you know, I'm really starting to like that look. Just the way he carries himself and everything. I see a ton of potential. I really, anytime where I sound tentative about the character of Aquaman, because the character's so important to me, I've always loved the casting. That never was an issue for me. I'm really behind the casting, as a matter of fact, of him. And I'm gonna butcher Jason's last name, which is why I'm deliberately not going to it, because I've loved him in everything he's been in, including his Netflix series, which I'm currently watching and enjoying. So he's just a great actor. So perfect choice for Aquaman. Glad to see what they did with it and how surprised. I love being surprised.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
And those moments where, you know, and I don't know if it's just the actor, this is his presence he gives, or if it was in the script that he was to do this. There was moments where, especially after that scene you talk about, because I completely agree with you, wonderful scene, seeing him driving and hold back the water. And that there was moments after that when he's just walking. He had the strut. You know, that noble warrior strut that you need, that confidence. And part of it is, I think the actor, I think that's just naturally how he is, because he is a badass in real life. So I think he has it. But it was just, especially I think within that armor, when he's wearing, when he's fully, you know, in the Aquaman moments, you could see the noble king that's waiting to just burst on the scene. And I think that for me, after that time where it was, that for me was his declaration of a hero. I am a hero. I am a champion. I'm going to fight for people. I'm going to join this team. After that moment, he had kind of more of a different presence to him. You know, when Bruce has that first interactions with him, he's a little bit more comical. He's a little bit more of a, you know, it's the, you know, he does protest too much kind of thing, where you could tell he's saying, oh, I don't care. And really, really? You kind of look like you do there, buddy, because you're a good guy. You're helping these complete and total strangers. You know, you don't need to. You could just let them die, but you don't. So, and it was kind of a cool thing, progression in the movie of this birth of a king.
Yeah, it's funny, as we're talking about this particular character, I do want to go to the Flash. He was an interesting one for me, because we're seeing a Barry Allen with a different sort of timeline than we're normally used to. We're used to the forensic scientist who's gone through the accident. We don't know entirely what happened to him. Like, we know that he was struck by lightning, and that's what caused it, because the film alludes to that. But he wasn't a forensic scientist yet. So we don't know when this happened for this Barry Allen. I grew to really like the character. I did find myself partway through the film wishing that he was Bart or Wally.
Yeah.
And yet, I loved the interaction with him and Henry Allen. And I liked at the end of the film when he held up, you know, I've got my job as a forensic scientist. He's somebody that I really need a solo film from to kind of get my head around this version of Barry Allen. Because these things I'm going to say are going to sound like criticism, because I liked him. I actually really liked him on the team. I liked that this was this green Flash. My only issue was that he was Barry Allen, and it's a small issue, tiny. It didn't take away from my enjoyment of the film. It's one of the reasons why, you know, if you're asking, like, why did you give it a B? Like, I'm not quite there with the Flash yet, but yet I'm saying I want to see a solo film with him, and I will be the first butt in the seat to go and see it, because I want this character fleshed out, and I want to know more. But I feel like I'm so used to my feeling on what Barry Allen is, that this kind of thief that's wandering around and doing, you know, these things because of his experience. I get it. His story with his dad and his mom has driven him, and he hasn't been able to quite get it together. The job as a forensic scientist is going to be our chance to kind of see him at the ground floor getting into that. So we're seeing Barry at a time that we're not really used to seeing him. So could this guy become Barry? And in many ways, you know, become a Barry that is so much closer than I'm imagining. Yeah, absolutely. But, you know, the fact that he was tripping and kind of bumbling in a couple little spots, I was like, I didn't dislike it. I get it. He's new. He's just getting used to using his powers for these purposes. I guess it's a sharp contrast to the TV series, where now he's a few seasons in and he's more seasoned. So yeah. I think that's what's hurting it more than, I don't want to say hurting it even, because it's not accurate. I had fun with him. I found him funny. Like the Batcave sequence. I'm like, when he was like almost, when he's inside the Batmobile and he's got the smile on his face, I'm like, I got more of the Impulse vibe there though. And that could be just, we've got a very young Barry who hasn't yet become the forensic scientist. We haven't seen him evolve. And he can become that character. So I'm not writing him off. I'm more of a, I'm still tentative on him, but yet I had a great time with him. So I want to see more. I liked the costume. I thought the thing that they did with the running with him was interesting, because it was more like he was skating than running, because his running looks very different. There were some pure geek out moments with him and Superman that I would not trade for anything in a million years. It's just, he's skewed very young for me. So he watches a lot more like Bart to me than he does Barry. And that's not a criticism. I love Bart. I almost wish they'd gone that route, but I don't dislike it. And I'm optimistic for I want to see the movie. I really want to see the movie. So it's kind of a strange sort of commentary on the character, because it sounds like I didn't like him, and it's not true at all. It's just, it's hard to compare that character in particular because of the TV portrayals of him.
Yeah, and it's funny because I'm agreeing with what you're saying, but you and I, again, we have different... we have different Flashes. You know, originally my Flash was Bart Allen.
Right.
That was my Flash. You know, so all these comments we're making, like, yeah, he's kind of like Bart. I'm like, yeah, he was. One of the reasons why I absolutely love this movie, you know, this movie version of the Flash. Now, I love the TV show, and that is Barry Allen. You know, and again, I've since come around saying, no, Barry Allen's my Flash. I love the fact that he stands for hope. He is the flashback, keep running forward, you know, flashback, you never stop running. I love that, just that positive, that optimism. He invoked the blue ring. He was able to actually pull that in, you know, when they had that whole, you know, the whole color war and everything that happened with each of the different league members getting a ring, he got hope. And there's a reason Barry got hope. And I love that about him. Coming into this movie, I was like, okay, he's younger, he's goofy, he's, you know, he's going to be the comedic sidekick. And I was worried that that would take away from the love that I have for Barry Allen. And it was funny because as seeing him get started, initially I recognized immediately, like you said, like, hey, this is Bart Allen. Okay. And then you started seeing, though, those glimmers of the guy who invokes hope, the guy who's going to keep running forward, who's not going to stop, who's going to keep pushing. And as part of it, you know, was his interaction with his father saying, don't, you know, when his father's like, don't come back. He's like, don't ever say that to me. I'm never going to stop. You know, and right there, I was like, okay, that's Barry right there. And then when he was sitting there and he's frozen with fear, and Bruce is like, just save one.
Oh, I love that.
Just save one. Mm-hmm. And he saves one. He goes, wait a minute. Then he goes and saves another, and he goes and saves, and then you're sitting there, you're like, I'm like, right there, that's Barry Allen. That's Barry Allen going to save the innocents while the others are doing the combat. And then by the end of the movie, what's he doing? He's like, you focus on the cube, I'm on bug patrol. And he's actually throwing down with the villains. He also saves the one family.
Ooh, gross. The villains.
It was awesome.
Yes.
You know, those are the things I was like, and he was grossed out about it. So it was a great comedic moment, but it was also, you see within the course of this movie, this character go from this kid who's petrified with fear to being the kid who keeps running forward, never stop. And right, for me, that in itself is the definition of who Barry Allen is. And I'm like, yes, this is young, but right there, we are seeing Barry Allen. And I was like, I was, by the end of the movie, again, I was hooping and hollering for this kid, and I absolutely loved the actor. So I knew I knew he would give a good, you know, acting portrayal. It was just depending on the character he was supposed to portray. And for me, I got my Bart Allen, a little bit of my Bart, but I also did get Barry.
Didn't you just say the same thing I did? How are we different on this? And I mean, I'm actually echoing this. I totally agree with you, but you like started off your comments by saying, and this is again where we're different. I'm like, wait, you just said what I said, and I agree with you. Because I mean, actually building off of what you're saying, in that sequence where he looks down and sees Wonder Woman falling, and he zooms on down and does that cool bit where he taps the sword with his finger.
Yeah.
And it goes over to Diana. Again, a heroic moment. This is the guy. I liked that journey. And I saw the Barry Bart amalgam that you're talking about. And that may be because he's skewed young. But you're right about the hope piece. I absolutely adored the pickup truck bit where you were going with that.
Yeah.
And I cut you off a little bit with that, so I apologize. When he told the girl to grab onto it and he was pushing her along, I loved that sequence because then he looks over to the right and sees Superman carrying a building. It was so awesome. Superman's costume in this. Oh my God, we have to talk about it.
Okay.
They changed the color a little bit. They brightened it up a bit, especially in that opening sequence with the podcast thing.
Yeah.
And the choice was striking because I really liked the decision, because the way they handled Henry Cavill in this, what I liked is that here's what was smart about this. I watched Batman v Superman yesterday before the Ultimate Edition, before going to see this. What I loved about watching that and then seeing this is they didn't throw out the window what they did before to brighten this universe up. What they did was they organically let storytelling drive us to where we got in this. And I really felt like so much more satisfied because they did this. So it's funny what I'm saying the movie would be. It's so strange to say that and be geeking out about it like I am. I mean it totally in the sense that if I'm analyzing it as a film, you can clearly see some spots where it's a little choppy. And when I say a little choppy, it's clear that they made some changes and adjustments. You can give me an Academy Award winner that I'm going to give an A+ to, and I'm probably never going to watch it again, but I can appreciate from a cinematic standpoint that this film from A to B was pretty flawless. This one was so much fun that I'll watch it over and over again, but it's a high B for me. But on an enjoyment factor, it's an A. And where the enjoyment factor is important to me is there's a lot of movies that are, I'll give an example, Michael J. Fox and Doc Hollywood. All right, some of you may be groaning as you hear that. I love that movie. I can watch it over and over and over again. If you were to ask me on my scale, what do I give that? That's a B at best. But I love it. Here's the thing. I love the characters. It's a Michael J. Fox vehicle. It was during that whole era of Back to the Future and stuff like that, where he was just creating certain movies that, you know, they put me in kind of a mood. I can watch that over and over again and smile. Do I think it is a cinematic masterpiece? No. Do I think it's a heck of a lot of fun? Yes. This is that kind of category. I will watch this over and over again. I want to see more footage from it in a way that I haven't been excited in a long time about a DC movie. And Wonder Woman started to do this with me. You know, I mean, as far as I've watched Wonder Woman over and over again because it's a feel-good movie. I've watched Batman v Superman again, but the problem with, I don't want to say it's the problem with that one. It sounds like I'm going back on what I said previously with that one, but where it's a hard rewatch is when you're looking for that Superman movie, I'll go to Superman 2, if I'm looking for the upbeat kind of da-da-da, you know, moment that you always talk about. I'll go to like a Batman Begins, which I really enjoyed. I watch Batman v Superman because I love the story and I love what they did with it. But I'm not getting that kind of, I feel like hoorah at the end of that one. This, I totally felt hoorah throughout. This will be an immediate shortlist of rewatchability again and again out of my DC movies because there was so many great team-up moments between these characters that just have me geeking out completely. The Steppenwolf fight at the end, and I know I'm jumping to something right now, but I would be remiss if I don't mention how much I enjoyed this choice. You bring Superman back in, and we're going to talk about all that, right? But the end fight with Steppenwolf, he's bringing up his axe, and we're at the final battle. The heroes have done their thing. Superman does the super breath bit. Who is the one that takes out Steppenwolf's axe, though? Wonder Woman's sword. I loved that choice of not making it Superman. Like, Superman having the super breath did its thing. But it was, Wonder Woman was already picking up her sword and walking over there before he even fired out that breath. You just saw a team that was, like, bound to determine, this dude is going down now, and we are going to do it. And lo and behold, they did. And it led to just that great bit with Batman and Aquaman, where Aquaman's like, do you smell that? And Batman's like, yeah, fear. And he swarmed on him. It was just so great. But I love that it was Wonder Woman sword coming down that did that, based off of the super breath. It was, you saw a lot of team dynamics in this, where they made the right choice of the right characters being in the right spots. And I don't know what came from what version of what script. I would love to see a documentary over how this film evolved, because I really enjoyed this. And I know there was some extensive reshoots done for this movie. So it's one of the reasons why I'm kind of like, you know, I watched this knowing that. So it may be part of my lens on it that I watched this in a way that I probably haven't any other DC movie, because I knew a lot of the behind the scenes stuff that was going on. And some of that influenced my feelings on Aquaman walking in. Which my face was totally slapped off of that, which I'm glad to say I'm a huge Aquaman fan from this. I don't know. I really loved the choice of Wonder Woman having that shining moment there. They spotlighted everybody. I didn't feel like any of the characters here. I didn't feel like Aquaman went to the background. Cyborg went to the background. Flash, Batman, Wonder Woman, Superman. They all had their moments in this. It was very balanced on that end. That part I thought was really a victory for them because I felt excited about all the characters at the end. There's nobody that I wasn't excited. I want to see a Cyborg movie. Like, I want all of these things from this. That's the victory. I think real victory out of this is, at the end, this was a great vehicle to get me excited about each of these characters.
Yeah, and here, I got to go back to something really quick about with my Flash comments and whatnot and all that stuff. Because it's funny because we are saying the same thing about the evolution of the character throughout it. But for me, that's what made this part, this an A movie, is because we saw these evolutions of these characters. We saw these growths of all these different characters. That, for me, again, I'm the progression guy. I want to say that. Well, in this movie, we saw the progression of all these different heroes. You know, we already had some established, but all the new introduction characters, you look at Flash, Cyborg, and Aquaman, all three of them are at a hero level by the end of the movie, and at the beginning of the movie, they weren't at that hero level. You know, and I think that for me has been that progression is the thing that makes this such a great superhero movie, is because we see progression of these characters. We already had three established solid heroes. One was dead, but we had the Trinity already established in the last movie, introduced three new characters. Three new characters go from characters to heroes by the end. And that's my thing, why I was saying I was looking at Flash differently than you were, because we both saw that, but I see that as something to say, you know, that this that's why I'm giving it an A as a superhero movie.
I said there were A sequences in this, and that would be one of my A sequences. So we're not really saying anything different as far as that piece goes, because I genuinely mean that. I think they're separate sequences. Here's a better way to put where my feelings are. Because I don't want to debate with you over the Flash thing, because I'm like, yes, you're right. So this I don't know. There's not a contradiction there. I think we both see the character the same way as far as what we liked about him. And the Barry Bart vibe, we both got that from it. So, I mean, I really liked Ezra Miller in this. So here's I started thinking this through. I'm like, where am I at on these films? And it's really a lot more than a lot different than the alphabet. As far as the recent four-film cycle, I look at, like, Man of Steel, Batman v Superman, Wonder Woman, and this. Because they're part of the same universe. Suicide Squad I'm not putting in there because it's own side. I guess it's part of it. But I feel like the Batman cameo in there was not enough for me to kind of go, it's integrated into this particular piece. I'd have to rework this. But Wonder Woman was flawless. I would put that as my number one out of those recent films. Such a great surprise. I love that the fact that they went to World War I. Like every sequence, the way that it was shot, the whole thing all the way through, I really feel like it should be up for award nominations. And if it's not, it's a travesty. Because I think it's just a really well-written, well-produced film, which is great characters, great story. That's the top of this heap. This is second to that. That's not a knock on this film. I think Wonder Woman is that good that I think if this film maybe had the benefit of not having the rewrites and things like that, I'd probably be saying the same thing about this. It sounds like I'm knocking this film. It's so not the case. It's more of I'm ranking them in my mind. After that would be Man of Steel and then Batman v Superman, as far as, you know, where I'm at as far as quality of these films. And I love Man of Steel. There was a majesty to Man of Steel and how it looked and things like that. I'm a fan of that film. I know some people thought it was a bit dark. I'm a fan of that film. I really liked the Ultimate Edition of Batman v Superman is what I'm referencing, by the way. I can't even remember what the theatrical release was like anymore. The Ultimate Edition, I thought, was a vast improvement of that film. So I'm not on the camp of I didn't like Batman v Superman. I liked the Ultimate Edition a great deal because I think it cleared up what I thought were flaws in that film. But I think in a ranking standpoint, that's where I'm at on these movies. Wonder Woman, I thought, was pretty flawless. So if I'm comparing the two films, and I'm really comparing this to Wonder Woman when I'm making a lot of my comments, I think Wonder Woman just was smooth. I mean, it's very, very smooth. This wasn't like jagged or anything, like by any stretch. I had so much fun with this. And this has the rewatchability Wonder Woman had. I think I walked in just expecting to look for sequences where, you know, it was clear there were some reshoots and things like that. So I saw some of that, but in a movie that I think came together to be something, I want this to do gangbusters because it deserves to. I think it's a fun movie. I can't tell you what my experience was in the movie theater when you kept hearing people say, oh, that was better than I thought it was going to be. That was fun. Like, I liked that. I got texts from my boss and another friend of mine who aren't like comic book fans like we are. But they enjoy, you know, these type of movies. And they both, you know, they were both like, really an enjoyable film. Like, really dug this one. They gave Thor, you know, they were like ranking between this and Thor. Thor got a slight nod over this one. And I actually agree with that. Because I love Thor. I thought Thor was just a great movie. That's not knocking this movie. I think putting this movie in the same lane as Thor is pretty accurate. Because I thought, like, very satisfying. This season, if these two films are any indication of what we've got coming with like Star Wars and stuff like that, I'm going to be a happy camper because we got Thor, we got this, we've got Star Wars coming. And if they're all this kind of quality, man, I like the idea that we're debating Thor and Justice League in the same breath instead of saying, man, I wish Justice League was as good as Thor. You know what I mean? I feel like this, it's not trying to be a Marvel movie, which I think was a huge feather in its cap. This really felt like a DC movie. And it's only second to Wonder Woman for me in this cycle. Suicide Squad, I don't know how I would fit it in to all this. I really had a lot of fun with Suicide Squad. I like that movie. I don't watch it as much as I thought I would, you know, like for rewatchability. I had a lot of fun with it, though, and I think there was a lot to love about that movie. I'm not knocking it now by saying that, but I think because it's a villain film, I'm having trouble plugging it in to where it fits in the rank-wise. I've never tried to do it with Guardians of the Galaxy, for example, either. You know, plug that into the Marvel movies. Not because I know that one's clearly part of the Marvel Universe. I think those movies are absolutely hysterical. Guardians of the Galaxy, Volume 1 and Volume 2. And I think they're just great stories. I just have trouble plugging them in with, like, Captain America and Iron Man and things and Thor. And things like that. So I don't know where you're at as far as these overall DC movies go, but Wonder Woman to me is the pinnacle because it was just so good.
Yeah, and I'm not going to argue with that. That one we're on agreement on. That, you know, and the ranking is pretty, you know, matching with us, with because definitely for me that Wonder Woman, you know, movie has the top line. Yeah, because everything you were saying, I was just nodding my head saying yes, because it was a solid Wonder Woman movie. It was a solid movie. It had great action moments, some real gripping humanistic moments in it that I was like, okay, this is a gripping film that, you know, and it also just the visual effects of it and just how they really captured just the chaos and the beautiful chaos that is war.
Yes.
And its destruction. They captured that so well in the Wonder Woman movie. And again, within the Justice League movie, those massive fight sequences.
Oh, yeah.
That was controlled, beautiful ballet of chaos and destruction. And that, for me, that was something I loved. Again, the team dynamic fighting. You know, whether it was, you know, Cyborg catching Aquaman landing on the Batmobile, Barry covering for, you know, Cyborg as he was doing it, Barry and Clark having their moments where they were rescuing people, the Barry and Wonder Woman and Batman fighting, doing some tag team combo mixes. Every character, they had, at one point in time, them doing different combos with each other. And I loved those moments because, again, that is a team dynamic fighting. The fact that they're all just coming together for the first time, and the first time they're in the groove just because it's, you know, you cover each other's back. I love those moments. And that was something I was like, I really was able to get more of a good solid grasp on the second watching through, where I'm sitting there just, you're watching that fight sequence going, this is awesome, you know? And it was a lot of just cheering moments for me throughout this. And again, mixed in with it, there were little comedic moments. And I think that is, if you have a nice blend of comedy and action, comedy and drama, you have that night. It's a good you need to have that, because you think about it, people will naturally, you know, through an uncomfortable position, will maybe try to try a little levity in the moment, and they'll have a little bit of laughter, or you have that final big epic end and you're like, oh, thank God. You know, you're going to chuckle a little bit. You're going to have that, just that release. And I love that was, again, a very natural reaction where they put some of those stuff in.
I like that at the end, I felt like they became friends, these people. And I felt like there's relationships to be built here. And I want to follow those relationships, see them develop, see where these characters go. It felt like a team that I want to follow and enjoy. And it felt like a DC team. You mentioned the fight sequences. I loved the effortless use of the slamming of the bracelets. Like, it's something that Wonder Woman builds up to. I thought it was really well done, because it's not something that I don't remember that being a thing in the comics. But I really like it as a movie choice. And I love the use of her lasso. I love the use of the sword. Her portrayal of Wonder Woman is just really, really strong. And I look forward to seeing her on the screen. In the comics, I've become a big Wonder Woman fan, but I think more so now the film has just upped it again to the point where I'm really captivated by this character. Yeah. And I think her portrayal is outstanding. So I'm glad there's a sequel that's been greenlit. I want to see another Wonder Woman movie. I want to see her again in Justice League. Anything we can do to get her into more of these movies as Wonder Woman is a, you know, they're doing a Flashpoint movie, I guess, with Flash. That's really the route that they're going. Great. Go ahead. Do that. Can we put Wonder Woman in it?
if they're doing a Flashpoint movie, they got to have, because she was one of the crucial characters in that Flashpoint story.
And Batman.
Batman, and Aquaman were three crucial characters that you have to have in Flashpoint. So I'll be very happy if they do that. So I'm like, okay, cool. Because I'm like you, 100% full support of her as Wonder Woman. Anything to do more movies for her, yes, yes, yes. And I was laughing with people at work because I was talking about Wonder Woman, and the one of my coworkers, she just kind of looks at me, rolls her eyes, and I go, hold on, it's not just because she's hot, because yes, she is, but she is an awesome character, she is an awesome actress, and she's doing a great job with this role, being just this powerful yet beautiful yet sympathetic warrior. You know, there are so many factions that make Wonder Woman such an awesome character, and she's doing a great job capturing them. And the writing for her movies are doing a great job capturing what Wonder Woman could do. But the writer can only go so far. The actress has to take it to that next level. And she's 100% taking it to the next level that I believe I'm looking at Wonder Woman on the screen when I see her in action. And it's just absolutely wonderful stuff. And so I'm completely head over heels agreement with you on her. It's, you know, she is the linchpin for this movie. She saved, you know, Batman versus Superman for both of us, I know, because she was that moment where, like, yes, we had to have her in there. She was that thing that, you know, and then her solo movie was absolutely unbelievable. So yeah, it's one of those things where any of the sequences she's in, I always cheered for. You know, so they had her nice spread. They knew where their, you know, they knew who their main star on this was. Batman, yes, he was one of the main characters, but she was the linchpin of the Justice League, and they did it so well.
See, this is actually an area where we do veer off. First, I'm not taking away anything you said about her being one of the linchpins, but I actually love the fact that Batman felt so good in this. And I really loved that, like, we went to this great opening Batman sequence where he was fighting, you know, one of Darkseid's,
Parademons.
Parademons. Thank you so much. Why am I trying a blank on that? But that was great in that Gotham sequence with the whole fear piece, how he's drawing them in. I liked that they played off the humanity of Batman in this, but yet pulled in the detective using the gadgets, Alfred, the partnership. This is a seasoned Batman. And I really felt in this movie that we got to see a very seasoned Batman in how he was operating. And it was the man, not the gadgets. Like, I loved that the gadgets were an enhancement, sure, but it was how the man used them that made this work so well. I really liked seeing the battle-torn Batman in this and how he overcame. I felt like there was a lot of hoorah moments for him in this. I liked that he wasn't the dark, brooding, I've got to kill Superman. I liked that movie a lot. So I want to be clear on that. But I even said that during that, that I wanted to see more from this Batman. Like, I want to see this Batman fleshed out. And I felt this film did a great job of that. Like, I want to see the solo film. I'm actually sad that the rumors continue to persist that, you know, this might be his last movie as Batman and that type of thing. I so hope that's wrong, because I really feel like in this movie, we got to see an evolution of his acting in it, and I don't want to diminish that, because I was walking out of this movie wanting more Batman too. That says something about how they handled him in this. I want to see him in a Batman solo movie. I want to see him in this Batman solo trilogy, and I know that there was like rumors like so recently like Jake Gyllenhaal might take over, which I like him too, so I've got no problem with that. But I just think Affleck in this one really came into his own. I really liked that. I wish in some ways that this movie had come before Batman v Superman. It would have made no sense because of what it did. But I mean, or a movie, I guess, more than anything, to give us an opportunity to get to know that Batman before they did that movie. Because I think that movie would have benefited from there being a Man of Steel sequel. We talked about this on the show, and a Batman solo movie beforehand. I think it would have just resonated better with people if they had done that. But I really liked him in this, and I loved how it went from that. We had that sequence also with Superman being interviewed, and that was when I first noticed the lighter costume. I liked how he was like, he was ready to fly off, and he was like, did Superman fashion? He's like, well, if it's for a podcast, he was recognizing it was for the kids.
Yes.
And it was that, like, to be, I felt like I was that kid. I loved the perspective. I loved that they were shooting that. And I'm like, oh, this is so cool, man. Superman's doing the interview. I felt like a kid again in that moment. And that's what I mean about sequences, where I can take sequences in this and go, man, as a movie, there's so many great A sequences in the whole thing. It was very hard for me not to say I'm giving the movie as a whole an A. It's more of looking at it from a, you know, cinematography standpoint. I guess I was looking at it on that end. But when I'm ranking it up where I am with Wonder Woman, you know, I'm saying a lot about this film. But that's a great geek out moment with Superman, that I really like him as Superman. And I hope we get another solo movie with him where we have a chance to see this evolution of him continue. I want to see more of his relationship with Lois Lane. That was a highlight for me in this movie. Like, his resurrection, the fight, and the reason for the fight, it was like what happens when somebody comes out of the Lazarus pit, right?
Yes.
He wasn't quite himself. The cyborg suit recognized that. You got to see this great battle between all of them that was Diana's pleading with him. I thought she took the forefront in that fight because Batman wasn't yet on the scene. And I thought that was really well handled. My favorite moment in that was the Flash.
Yes, I was just about to say that, man. I loved those moments, especially one, the lead up where he's like, is he going to come back? Yay. Or is he going to come back? Pet Cemetery.
And yes.
I cheered both times I saw it. The theater laughed both times that sequence came out, but especially during that fight sequence, as Flash is running up and then Superman just turns his head and Flash is like, oh no, he can see me. He as fast as me, and just a look on his face, that was just the absolute one. I absolutely cheered, laughed both times, even though you know it's coming. That second time, I know it's coming. Just when he just slowly turns his head and he looks and he's like, oh no. And the fight, the high speed fight sequence between Flash and Superman was absolutely wonderful. That whole thing was laid out perfect. I loved those moments, that whole resurrection scene. You know, I didn't have, it was weird because I was sitting there and I'm trying to think, you know, before the movie came out, how are they going to bring him back? Is it going to be like it was in the comic? But it couldn't be because he was buried in the ground in the movies, you know, and this and that. I'm going through all these different combos. The simple explanation, well, the quote unquote simple explanation they gave was worked. It was a great moment. I liked, again, how he came out and he wasn't, you know, completely all there. He was kind of mixed up, confused. I love the bring in the big guns. That, again, I knew, you know, going into the first time watching, I knew exactly who the big guns were going to be. I knew exactly what he was going to do, but I still cheered when Lois showed up. It was one of those things where that was, for me, was a great layout of a story.
I'll admit they swerved me on that. Because when they were mentioning big guns earlier, I was thinking he was going to do kryptonite or something like that. I totally get, like, why you reached that logical conclusion. That's great. I can totally see, like, there was nothing in the film that wouldn't indicate that that was going to be the case. When she showed up, it made perfect sense, and it felt so right, and it was a great move. I was shocked. I wasn't shocked by that. I don't want to go that far with it. I was hoorahing, because I was like, oh, yeah, that makes sense. Lois is the big guns. I was thinking more Kryptonite or something like that, that he was going to do that end. Lois showing up in that sequence and that emotional moment between the two of them was so good. When they flew off together, you knew he still wasn't quite himself, but you could see like the tears in his eyes as well as hers. I liked that coming back to life in this film was not just kind of this light switch. And he's Superman again. Everything's great. No, that is, you're talking about somebody who is dead. Now they've been resurrected. That should be jarring. You're playing with the forces of nature. And I'm glad that was a debate in this film. That was something I thought they did really well, too. See, it's funny. Like, when I say hi, Bill, B, for this film, people are going to be kind of like, how did you... You sound like you adored this movie. I did. I so did.
I know. I'm confused, man.
It's not... It really is... There was... When I was looking at the film, there's certain parts that felt disjointed to me. And when I say that, it's nitpicky. And it's more of looking, I was looking for the fact that there were multiple screenwriters and that this film went through reshoots. So I think I went into my first viewing looking for that, and I noticed those things because I was looking for them. So I guess I'm putting that piece in just as an objective viewer going, I did notice some of this. I will say everything that I'm saying I noticed in my first watch, I totally was oblivious to in my second watch through because my baggage was gone. Like, I went into the first viewing with some biases and some things that I'd heard and stuff like that. And I encourage everybody who saw this to do a second viewing because my second viewing was just fun. And at the end, when it comes to films that are rewatchable for me, it's the fun factor that makes that decision. This fun factor in this might be, this is might be where there's blasphemy, that might give it a slight edge in rewatchability for Wonder Woman for me, only because the fun factor in this was so good. I'm going to have a tough time with that one because Wonder Woman is fantastic. So I do want to say that piece. It's funny. You can give a movie a certain grade and kind of go, but I'll rewatch it over and over again because it was just fun. And that's something that I really liked about this film. But the Superman relationship with Lois going back to the Kent farm, there were so many moments. Like, I wanted to see them acknowledge the ring. I wanted to, you know, there's so much I wanted packed into this film that we didn't get to see, but that's anticipation, right? Yeah. You should want that. I love that bit where she's like, I'm regretting that you're, and I'm poorly paraphrasing it, but I'm regretting the fact that you got better so quickly because I'm going to have to send you away. And, you know, the Bruce bit and they had the conversation there and he's like, I did owe him. I loved this whole sense of, I want life. You know, it's her saying, you can't die again. You know, this can't happen. Yeah. And I liked her. I did not feel it diminished anything from Lois Lane for her to say I was weak, you know, during those moments. I think there's strength sometimes in, because I consider Lois Lane a very strong character. And actually, Amy Adams' portrayal in Lois Lane is very strong. I liked that the character revealed, like, you know, I was weak during parts of this. I had kind of walked away from part of who I am. And the two of them kind of being in this moment where he had his own weakness that we saw and kind of coming together, and you can see them as a couple making each other stronger. He was getting strength from her. She was getting strength from him. At least that's how I was watching it. And what I love so much about that moment is you saw to me a template of what's best about these two. They are the yin and the yang for each other and they make each other better. It's not Superman saving the day for Lois. It's Lois in many ways tapping into what's best about him too. And those human moments, and she called his mom, and he's like, you called mom. And like so much of that, I think, led to the powerful guy that we saw later when he came back. Those moments were the ones where I'm like, I want to see him come in there and kick Steppenwolf's butt. And it was those endearing moments. Diane Lane is Martha Kent, I think, does a great job. And, you know, from the house foreclosure to, I so knew where that was going to go when it was foreclosed. I'm like, oh, Bruce is going to fix this. But here's the thing. It's not, you said this something about this earlier. Sometimes it doesn't matter that you know. It's how you get there. You mentioned that you saw the Aquaman scene in the previews. Doesn't matter that you've seen it. It's the journey to get to that scene enhances it. It didn't matter that we knew that the house was going to be saved. It was how it was saved and what that looked like. And that moment with Clark and Bruce at the end was so powerful where, you know, it was fun. These two people who have now become friends, because I don't not like you, turned into, I actually really do like you and I feel like I owe you. I goofed. I made a huge mistake with you. I understand you now, and this is about making this right. And the buying the bank thing where he's like, yeah, I sometimes get impulsive with this kind of stuff. I just loved that. It was such a great Bruce and Clark moment that just made me really glad that this movie felt so much like a DC Universe movie. And it is one of the reasons why it's such a close second to Wonder Woman is because of the DC feel, because it's the first movie in a while where I felt like we got to see Superman and Batman and actually having a DC feel.
Oh, definitely. 100% agree with you. And I don't know about your theater, but I found the theater where I went to when that whole Clark, you know, the whole Lois and Clark moment, you know, and then especially when, you know, mom showed up and that you called mom, you know, and at my theater, I'm not sure, they pumped a bunch of dust in the air vents, you know, because my eyes started tearing up because of the dust they were pumping into the theater. So that for me, I'm a little upset at the movie theaters for doing that, you know, because it's just that gripping moment of,
yes,
you know, and, but, what?
Yes. No, yeah, I know where you're going. Too, huh? It was honestly, it was such it's why I was touting the fact that I want to see another Superman movie with Henry Cavill. And if I'm butchering his last name, I really apologize, because I think he and Amy Adams really play off each other so well. It says a lot when I'm not focused on the fact that she has red hair. You know what I mean? It's kind of a she's Lois Lane to me in her portrayal. And I've become really convinced that she understands the character and the balance of strength and vulnerability in Lois Lane that we've seen in Man of Steel, Batman v Superman, and here has been very consistent and has only grown. And I've loved their story arc and their journey. I want to see them get married. I want to see them have the kid. I want to, you know, I want all these things to happen on screen. So I'm hoping that out of the reviews of this film and out of people's commentary, that they're getting behind these characters finally, and we get to see something. The evolution, I think, has been a positive, and I'm glad they didn't just drop us into, well, now all of a sudden they're happy-go-lucky. Yes. No, you got to build to that in story. You know, it's like you told a story arc in Man of Steel that led to Batman v Superman to this now. The journey makes sense with them. Like, at the end, this Superman who was laughing with Cyborg on the ground was such a great moment. I love this guy. What a great way to bring us to a place right now where I'm like, it means so much more because of where he came from, to see him there in that moment. I love that. I absolutely adored that side. I know you went there early, and you were so right, too, because that is one of the better moments of the doggone thing.
Oh, God, yeah. And just this Superman, this is the more positive dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun Superman that, yes, I wanted. You know, because when the first Man of Steel came out, there was that darkness too. I'm like, you know what? But this could be the beginning of that Superman. And then there was never the follow-up. And then Batman versus Superman. Okay, yeah, we got to see a little bit more of the more positive Superman. Still a little bit darker, but there was the glimmers of that possibility. This one right here, we got to actually see those great moments that I love about Superman. And the fact that I did love the fact that they did use part of the Superman theme in the movie and where they used it. When he first shows up to Steppenwolf, dun, 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 dun. And then right as he's punching him, bum, ba, da. I cheered. I literally cheered in the movie theater. And I did that both times, by the way, because it was just one of those things where you're like, yes, there's the big blue. We're about to, you know, things are about to go really bad for the bad guys. And it was those positive, powerful moments that you need to have in a Superman movie. We saw that. The positive, powerful moments you need to have in a Batman movie. You got to see that. You got to see the detective. You got to see the strategy of Batman in everything he was dealing with, the parademons from laying out his game plans and just all the contingency plans he had lined up. That right there was Batman. You got to see the Flash, the keep running forward, Aquaman, powerful King of Atlantis, and Cyborg. I absolutely loved Cyborg. We haven't talked much about him throughout this so far, but I want to make sure that Cyborg was an absolutely beautiful construction in how they did him, where it was the initial where he had that bitterness, then he started developing into the character, then he did, by the end, he was the hero. And both times when he did the booyah, I cheered, you know, and I wasn't the only one cheering for the booyah. That was especially that second showing, there was a lot of people cheered out loud when he just says booyah. I go, yes, Cyborg. I was so thrilled about these characters, man. I'm like, I'm eagerly looking forward to Justice League 2, looking forward to any of the solo movies they may do for these guys. I would love to see a Cyborg solo just because, you know, there's so much more they can do with him now that he's, you know, Cyborg. Let's actually explore what it is to be the hero that is Cyborg. What, you know, kind of give him his own kind of little adventure or whatnot. I'm not sure what they're going to do. I'm all for it.
His dad was great. It was Joe Morton who played Silas Stone. I thought that was really well done. I thought the casting of a lot of the support characters that we only got to see, you know, in limited roles. We got to see a lot more of him, though. And especially with him and the link. I'm glad that they put in the link to Darkseid. We didn't get a lot of Darkseid mentioned, which is clear that they've changed the direction of that. Because was Darkseid mentioned at all?
Yeah. When Steppenwolf mentioned it, he said, for the unity, for Darkseid.
Okay.
You know, so there was he was mentioned.
But Mother was more of Steppenwolf's focus.
Right.
So it became really clear that we weren't heading in a Darkseid route right now. I'm torn on that just because I wanted to see where that was going to go. But I think it's a positive only in the sense that with what's going on with Thanos and Marvel, I think they did a really good job in this one of separating themselves from being a Marvel movie. So yes. I think right now, let's build off of this. I want to see Luthor in the Injustice League versus the Justice League. That I want to see. And I would love to see the Darkseid battle. Don't get me wrong. But I think what you want to do right now, and this is what DC really needs to, I don't want to say maybe it's playing catch-up ball. I think this film did a leaps and bounds of playing catch-up ball in my mind. I feel they're in a good place with this universe right now. I don't know what the sales are for this film, but I hope it's doing gangbusters and it's getting, because it's funny how you can see Michael Sangiacomo, who does San Giacomo, or I forget how he pronounces his last name, so I apologize for name butchery on this. He does the reviews for The Plain Dealer. And I really largely agreed with his review. He gave it a B in his review. But the tagline makes it sound like, you know, it didn't really represent the comics well. And I'm like sitting here, but like, it did. I'm like, that's what I liked about it, is it felt very connected. And he mentioned something about not doing the comics justice. And I'm like, I don't know that we need to slam this. How do you give a movie a B and slam it? A B is a good grade for a movie. Yeah. You know, when you're giving it like a C or a D or below, you know, then you're like really got some issues. I'm like, this is really a good movie. But I've been seeing a lot of positive reviews. I haven't seen any so far that have really slammed it. I agree with some of the criticisms I've seen about, you know, certain disjointed aspects, but they're minor. You really got to be nitpicky to, like, make that drive your experience with this, because that's what it's about, the experience. And I saw this in 3D both times at Great Lakes Mall. They also had dust. And I honestly got the emotional part more the second time through, even, because I think the second time through, I just really went in and enjoyed the Cyborg moments with his dad, all the Superman moments and things that I liked. You know, Cyborg, you mentioned that we haven't talked a lot about him. Cyborg, I really liked the separation from humanity and embarrassment almost with society. I love that when they had him in his, what do you call it, sweats, you know, kind of hiding away from everything, that he felt like he was shutting himself off from humanity. I like that this story, I think it did something unique in building the sense of terror, being a prisoner in your own robotic body, because his body took over on him more than once in this film. That was like a horror piece to me, you know, where like he started attacking Superman, he started attacking Aquaman, and it wasn't him, it was his body, the Cyborg body that was taking over. And just a real sense of what that's like. There's an interesting film there. And I know it's that film, I'm almost positive, has been greenlit.
Oh, cool.
I think that's part of the DC movie phase. And if not, boy, they really should, because that was a phenomenal.
Yeah. And in the cyborg moments, one of my favorite scenes is with him and his dad. When talking about how Cyborg hasn't been out, how he, you know, they haven't told anybody about that. And Cyborg goes, "You're afraid they'll see the monster." And the dad's like, "You're not a monster." He goes, "Funny how you thought I was talking about myself." I love that moment because he's basically calling his father a monster for what he did to him. And I that for me was just that great interaction, that great powerful interaction between the two of them. And then especially to see later on when it's the kidnapping of his father that really pulls Cyborg into the team. You know, and the fact that he's there to save his father. He's there to help his father. And then he's there to help continue to save the world. And it's, again, it's that evolution of the hero where you now can see the future between Cyborg and his dad is going to be better. There's still going to be some rocky roads between the two of them. You know, there's going to be issues. There's always going to be issues. But you're going to see that more positive relationship between the two of them just because one, Cyborg's accepting who he is. You know, he's actually probably going to even consider himself still to be Victor Stone. And I love how he, you know, throughout the movie, he wasn't Victor anymore. It's like, I was Victor. I'm something else now. And it's that whole, again, it's that whole duality of, you know, with the man and the machine and how he's not who he was anymore. By the end of the movie, we saw Victor was back. You know, even through that little fist bump between him and Flash, you know, right at the end of the movie with the booyah, with just him laughing about his toes are hurting. And just that funny moments, you're seeing the man come back. And again, it was evolutions like that that made me just absolutely love these characters and love this movie, how much they were able to fit into the 2 hours. They did a great job with it. And like you, I want to see more of the, you know, the edited stuff, because we know there's a scene where Clark flies into the cave. Because, you know, in the previews, we see Alfred talking to someone. He said, "You may show up." And obviously that was Superman and they cut it out of the movie. So I want to see if there was anything more in the dialogue between there. And, you know, there's probably a little bit more of dialogue between Lois and Clark or Clark and Martha. I want to see those kind of sequences if they add it, if they cut anything out for just because of time wise. They're already at the 2 hour mark. OK, so we got to do some more trimming. So for me, I'm always about director's cuts. I'm always about the extended scenes. But, you know, it's I don't know. You know, I'm sitting there going, yeah, and this and this and that and this. I'm jumping around the place, you know, and I think part of that is excitement. Part of that is wonder of what's going to be the future, because, you know, Justice League 2, you know, I don't, you know, the solo movies, I'm all in on this. Let's keep the machine going here.
The Cyborg movie, I was just reading an article on it from Cinema Blend, and I don't know where we're at on this. It was originally slated for 2020, but there's been a lot of changes to the docket because there's a Joss Whedon Batgirl movie that's on the slate. There's a Chris McKay Nightwing movie. There's the Flashpoint movie. So I don't know that this is officially on the slate still.
Okay.
But I honestly think, my personal take on this, if I were booking a Cyborg movie based on where the character was left at the end of this film, I would almost do Justice League 2 first, then do a Cyborg solo movie. Only because in Justice League 2, you give the guy more of a chance to be fleshed out as a member of the team. You know, get to kind of see him be that super cool hero as a part of the team. And then go into that. Because I'm even questioning Flashpoint as a starting movie for Flash. You know what I mean? It's to try and get... not. I want to see it. Don't get me wrong.
Yes, I know.
It's more of a, I'm thinking of general audiences. Like, you're trying to introduce a new audience, and to put him in this bizarre other universe where we're taking some of our heroes and twisting them.
And twisting them, yeah.
I don't know. I'd love to see a positive Flash movie before you go to that route, because that's a dark universe. And I want to see it. I'm excited for it. So that's not a knock. It's more I'm thinking big picture. And like Cyborg, I want Cyborg to be successful. I think it can be a successful movie. I think it could be a great vehicle to launch the character before a second Justice League. So I'm not against it. It's just more of a, I don't want it to be a missed movie because there isn't an awareness enough awareness of the character. I think what'll decide this is how successful Justice League is. If this movie's really successful, he is applauded as one of the reasons, then absolutely you should green light and fast track Cyborg. If the movie's applauded, there isn't a ton of buzz around the character yet, I would do the sequel.
I agree with that. I would go along with that as well. I want more, but you know, again, it's part of the, you don't want to hurt the character. Now with the Flashpoint thing, on one hand, I'm like, yeah, it's a weird thing to do because non-comic book fans are going to get there's going to be a really good potential for confusion. And part of the reason I say this is because, like, with my family, when they're dealing with the alternate universes, when they're dealing with, you know, other stories like that, they will get a little, hey, who's this? What's going on here? What's this? You know, so I'll get questions on that from family and friends. You know, for us, it's second nature to see, okay, to see the, you know, the butterfly effect from the alternate version. So I agree with you in your sentiment, but on the one hand, a young, inexperienced Barry is more likely to do a time travel that alters the time, that changes. He's more likely to do an actual Flashpoint where he goes back in time and tries to alter things to make things for the better and completely screws up the universe. So in a way, a younger Barry, it fits the story that he would try something like that.
I think the problem my problem with that is twofold. First of all, I agree with everything you're saying. Let me clarify first.
We both want to go any further.
I want to see it. If they put it out tomorrow, I'm going to be the first one in line to go see it. The problem is it's been done on television. They did a version of Flashpoint on TV already. So it's an interesting thing to, obviously you can do it so differently on the screen and you can bring in the film universe characters and really play around with this. And have some fun with it and make it a great movie. I'm all in. Here's the thing. I want to know more about this Flash. And what you presented is something I'd like to see. Sure, young and experienced Barry doing that makes a lot of sense to me. You could tell a great story with that. My concern is, I would want the film to be able to bring into Wonder Woman, Aquaman, Batman. And the problem is, you're putting all of those characters in a dark situation. Not that I'm against, you know, the movie being dark. It's just this movie was, I think, a step out into the light for the DC films and showing how you can do that and really make a fun and exciting film. I think before they journey back into the dark, let's get a few more of these under the belt and then make it a contrast, not a tone shift. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So, I mean, that's my only concern with it. It's not, here's the thing. I can separate it. You can separate it. I don't think your average movie-going audience who's aware of how this plays in comics is going to necessarily do that just because that's been a criticism on the DC movies. So my concern with that is not that I think it's going to be, I want to see it. And I think you can save it and make it light. This is where I'm going to correct myself a little bit. Ezra Miller is so fun, to the point where I walked in wanting Grant Gustin. I walked out really enjoying his portrayal. So my sort of tentativeness with him is not really. I mean, I enjoy his Flash. That was fun. And I loved the fun factor he brought to it. I want to see more of this character. So you got me. He's the one guy, if you do it right, that you can make this a bright movie. You've got to, though. It's got to be a bright movie. With the darkness mixed in. You've got to have your shining light. And the other way to do it is, if you do bring in Wonder Woman and Aquaman, you've got to, in the epilogue of the film, show us how different they are in our world.
Yeah.
To capstone it off and go, this is only because he did this.
Right, yeah. No, I agree. And it's funny because as we're talking, I'm thinking I would really like to see this Flash up against the Rogues. Because the Flash has arguably one of the best Rogues gallery. You know, Batman does have a very famous gallery and they are very cool. But there is something about the Flash's Rogues that I would like to see this Barry Allen go up against them. Because, again, it would be definitely a different story how he would handle them. So you know, it's again, we're both saying we want Flashpoint. I'm saying I understand how this Barry could make a Flashpoint, but on the other hand, I'm agreeing with you that there could be some confusion among people. And I think a better route maybe would be to go with some rogues, because that would be more of a, the, you know, the movie audience would have a better grasp of them. Comic book fans would love to see the rogues, because on the big screen, I don't know if we really ever had a good portrayal of the rogues before. So let's bring them in. Plus, that could help out with the next Justice League movie, because if they're building a a Legion of Doom or Injustice League or whatever they're building, they're going to need a Flash villain to add to their team. So, hey, let's have in the Flash movie, let's introduce one of the people they may take, or multiple people they may take.
Yeah, yeah. It's well, your Flashpoint's been greenlit. So, I mean, it's a thing.
Yeah, I know. But yeah.
And here's the thing. You can so do that movie and make it work. So I'm giving high hopes that it's going to do what I'm hoping it does and have a prologue and an epilogue that kind of brings it all together. I'm excited for that. I think it's the part where I think it's interesting is you're establishing a love for his world before he goes back and changes it, without having established a love for his world before he goes back. And
right.
You know what I mean? That's where the TV series, I think, had the advantage of, we've had time under our belts to really like Barry Allen's world.
And now we're changing it. Yeah.
So the onus is on the filmmaker and the writers to really make that happen in a film. I think you can do it. And if they nail it and it's a home run, it's going to be a great movie. So yeah. I'm saying that, not downplaying it. I have high hopes. I want it to be great. So it's interesting out of this to see with the film docket slate where we want this to go. I'm glad we got a Wonder Woman 2 coming out of this. The Batman situation seems to be, I don't want to say a mess, because it seems like there's some confusion as far as what they're doing. I'm hoping for some news on that soon. Like, I'm hoping this is really successful. And if Affleck really wants out, I'm hoping, you know, we get somebody good in there. Maybe it is Jake Gyllenhaal. I don't care who it is. I just want somebody good in there. Because Ben Affleck, I think, has just been great. I really think this movie showed me what I want out of a Ben Affleck Batman movie. And I want to see a solo film for any of the characters in this movie.
Yes, I agree. And I'm hoping that the possibility of Ben leaving was just because of all the criticism and all the attacks against him. I'm hoping this movie will show people, see, he can do this role. He does it well. He does it good. He's a good Batman. Let's see. Let's give him his solo project. I'm hoping this will be an encouragement for him to, you know, for him to stay in the role, for them to, you know, entrust it. I don't know on what side is causing the friction, whether it's Ben Affleck saying he doesn't want to play the role, or whether it's the studio saying they don't want him. I'm hoping this movie can help put aside anybody's doubts or anybody's animosity towards him, because I do want to see that solo. And it's one of the interesting things with his portrayal in this. There's a piece that they did with him that should have annoyed me, and it should have angered me. And for some reason, you know, when I first saw it, I was like, what? And then I started, as the movie's going on, I started thinking about it. I'm like, you know, this makes sense. And it's, you know, the simple fact that Bruce was very open with his secret identity to people he didn't know or trust. And I'm talking specifically Aquaman and the Flash. During his recruitment, he basically tells both of them, I am Batman. You know, completely going against anything you would think Bruce would do. But that was the thing that they really portrayed in this movie, where, especially in some of his dialogues with Diana, where he's saying, hey, I'm trying to be a different person. I'm trying to be a better person. And this is Bruce Wayne's recognizing that, you know, my standoffish, that the wall I put up and blocking people out isn't going to recruit these people. I have to be completely open. I have to be completely trusting in these people that I am asking to put their life on the line. And I love the fact, and that was something that I was like, you know what? I love the fact that he told them up front who he is, and he completely opened up for him. And I was like, that again was something, if, you know, I heard, if someone had said Bruce tells him right away, I would have been pissed off. Or, you know, seeing, you know, when he first started talking, I'm like, what? You know, but you see the character, why he did it. You know, they don't flat out say, he doesn't flat out and say, well, I'm telling people my secret identity so they'll trust me and we can form a team. No, But that was actually why he was doing it in his other dialogues. And I liked that. And that was something that would have really thrown me off, but instead endeared me towards his portrayal and his role.
It gave a real sense of the end of the world. That really worked for me. The way that they were handling this. And also the personal connection between them. I'm not a fan of that usually either. I'm actually going to, and this is, I'm going to correct something or tell you how I view Batman differently than you do. I thought this was a great portrayal of Batman. And I wouldn't have, I'm not trying to backpedal anything I may have said previously. I've always felt like Ben Affleck could play a great Batman. I thought he was a good one in Batman v Superman, and I enjoyed that movie. I felt like we never got a chance to see that character fully fleshed out. This was a great portrayal of Batman from him. And distinctively improved upon what he's done previously with the character. I agreed with what you said earlier. We got to see a lot more great Bruce Wayne in this. I felt like I wish we got to see this Batman in some format before Batman v Superman, just because I think that film would have been a lot better received, because he really understands the duality of the character, but also the tormented nature of the character and the human side of him and what he goes through and the sense of the battle. I thought was something that we got to see here in a way that was really well done. I would love to see him have another opportunity, another stab at this character. And I'm hoping that this is, rightfully so, better received by critics for him. Because I liked his portrayal of Batman every bit as much as I loved Gal Gadot's Wonder Woman and Henry Cavill's Superman. I thought they were great. All the casting of the heroes in this I thought were really well done. So I would say great to all of them. Flash is the only one that I'm still wrapping my head around, but there's a sense of excitement there now after seeing the movie. Whereas when I was talking last week about it, I was very worried I wasn't going to like him. And now I do. I really like him. I'm getting the multiverse vibe from him.
Yes.
Like, I'm like, okay, this isn't the TV Barry, but this is Barry. And I'm excited to see where this goes. So that part's fun for me. I don't know. This was just, there's so much hope coming out of this. I don't feel like I'm defending this movie, which feels so good. This is something which is interesting compared to Batman v Superman. We had that conversation. I felt like we were walking in defending the movie, and I don't feel that with this particular film.
No, definitely. I don't think we have to defend this movie.
No.
This movie is a solid, as I said, it's a solid superhero movie. It's a good, it's a really good, Batman movie, good Superman movie, good Wonder Woman, good, it's all the characters. They did a great job with all the characters. It's what I want in a superhero movie. I want to go in there, have fun. I want I want some hoorah moments. I got some hoorah moments. I got some serious, actual movie moments. Where it actually there's difference between, just having a bunch of people beat people up and, big giant special effects movies kind of stuff where you're like, oh, okay, that was a fun watch, but not what I would call a movie. This had those movie moments where you actually have to have actors do a job that, there's a skill set that's required. And you can actually see some actors flexing some acting muscles. They show their chops in this movie. And you had to have those moments where you have that where, like, okay, especially, as I said, the Cyborg, him and his father moments, those interactions were absolutely wonderful. The Bruce and Diana moments, those are two talented actors doing their job, showing us why they're actors and why we are watchers. There's a reason why I'm not an actor, because I can't pull out that emotion. I can't do that kind of stuff. Just what they use, how they portray these characters, how they become these characters, make you believe, completely drop down, just that suspension of disbelief, and you're right in there in the movie with them. That we got to see some of that really cool moments. Plus, we also got to see some great, fight sequences. We got to see some funny moments. This, for me, is just this great movie. It's a solid movie, and yeah, I'm so happy. I'm so happy that, for me, this was an easy conversation where I can just say, this was awesome. This was awesome. This was awesome.
Who would you like to see on the Injustice League? I haven't really thought this out, so I'm asking a question that I haven't thought out myself.
Well, obviously, Luthor is wonderful. I'm glad because one of my biggest beefs I had with Batman versus Superman was Luthor wasn't the Luthor I love. You know, he wasn't just that, you know, that businessman, that calculated machine, you know, that is, that makes that awesome Luther where you're like, on one hand, you're like, I understand what he's doing. He's trying to save the world. He's killing a lot of people and doing it, but he is trying to save the world. And that's the Luther I love. And I didn't completely get that from the last movie. Now I'm hoping that we can fix that, because in a way, you know, that one little brief moment when he's sitting there, he kind of had that look to him that I'm like, okay, maybe they're getting rid of the goofiness. Maybe they're saying he was more under influence than we realized and yada, yada, yada. So I'm like, okay, let's see there. Obviously, I always love Wilson, and, you know, I always love Deathstroke. He's just absolutely wonderful. So that's going to be a great villain to add to the mix. Again, one of the Flash rogues, you know, we could go with, you know, one of the speedsters or any of the other rogues. We can deal with solid. I don't know what kind of thing, you know, Black Manta is always my first go-to. You know, when you're dealing with Aquaman, that's a good counterbalance to him. Cyborg, I don't know what we're going to get. And Wonder Woman, I don't know what we can go with, because we haven't really seen any major villainesses from her, or villains, or any of the bad guys that she normally faces, because, you know, this Wonder Woman has been kind of, you know, relatively in hiding.
Yeah, and they started to address some of that, which I really liked, because it's something that doesn't match the character for me. But I liked her humanity in this. And those moments where we got to see her with Bruce, I thought were really well done from her character's perspective, too. Why that leadership conversation, I think, explained a lot and showed how these characters through this circumstance have evolved. And I thought it was that's one of the reasons why I think everything I can level at Wonder Woman being great in this, you have to level at Batman, too, because some of my favorite interactions were those two. I love what she did with Cyborg. I thought she was a connection to the humanity of Cyborg. It's one of the, I want to be careful how I say this, because I love Cyborg in this. I felt like he's a character that we still need to get to know, and I want to get to know him. And what I mean by that is, I think we got to see his humanity and his hoorah moments in the latter parts of the film. And I think he's a character that's ripe for strong character development. I will go see his solo movie in an instant, because I think that the actor hit it out of the park. I think his dad hit it out of the park. I think we're ready to go. I mean, I'm as far as that goes. The buzz off of this film is what's going to generate that, because the buzz was significant enough with Batman v Superman, with Wonder Woman, to like garner an interest in a solo movie for her. If there's enough buzz around him in this movie, you can push forward that solo movie with him right now. If not, I would do a sequel, then do a solo movie. That's my only caution with him, just because I want the Cyborg solo movie to launch a series. I don't want it to be a done in one. I would love a series of Cyborg solo movies, because I think he's an interesting character. I think there's a lot you can do with him and really make him a different sort of hero. And I honestly think he has a lot of potential with the amount of tech and what you can do with him on the screen nowadays to be a breakout character, because he'd be a great video game as well. And I mean, you got to look at these characters and go, do they have a multimedia presence? And Cyborg, toys, video games, cartoon series, all of that stuff, he's like primed to be like this character that breaks out. And everything that we used to say about Blue Beetle in the past, you certainly can put on Cyborg as well. And I think now he's more primed than any other unique new DC character. Because here's the thing, Cyborg to the Justice League, as far as the history of the Justice League, is relatively a new development. You know, it's only been since the launch of the New 52 that he's been a power player on that team. So now I love the decision. I love that he's come to the forefront in this film. There's an opportunity here with him to be something unique and to really take off as a star. And I hope that it's given the right decisions to make it work. Because on paper, this one's a no-brainer. I mean, it could really work. So, Jim, I was looking online, and I did find the opening box office, and it's not good. It got $96 million, which sounds like a lot of money, but by comparison, it is actually the lowest launch of this batch, you know, with Batman, Superman, Dawn of Justice, 166 million, Suicide Squad, 133, Man of Steel, 116, Wonder Woman, 103. Like Thor, for example, which just opened recently, opened to 122 million. It looks like international sales are 185 million, which is better news, I guess, led by China. Mm-hmm. But I'm hoping, it's funny, the Warner Brothers director of distribution was like quoted as saying that they have high hopes because from Friday to Saturday the numbers were increasing. And we're going into Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday, where more and more kids are off of school because of the holidays. So there's, you know, so the question is, you know, did some families wait until, you know, they're off for the holidays before hitting the theaters? So hopefully this gets a momentum push from it. But the reviews are very mixed, which is part of the problem as well. And I don't get that. I stand behind, I don't even say my criticisms, like kind of where I graded it, but that's a good grading for a movie. I mean, that's like a go see it. What I suggest to people, and one of the reasons why I even bring up numbers, because, you know, I don't usually like to spend a lot of time on them with either comics or on film, but I feel this is a really great movie. I think it's important that word of mouth, you know, like we are, if you're listening to this, I never want people to manufacture praise or following things. We share what we genuinely feel about things here. So when we geek out about something, it's because we really enjoyed it and want to talk about it. Even if it's something other people didn't like, you know, sometimes that's interesting to just have a different opinion. In this particular case, I really like this movie a lot and I want more. So we have to, as fans, speak and help out, get on social media, get viral, you know, to retweet and share things out to people and let them know that you were part of the crowd that liked this movie and what you liked about it. What made this one different? Because, you know, a lot of times you've got to counter. It's strange to see positive reviews to this that have negative headlines. And I literally saw that in like a number of cases where I'm like, how do you give a movie a B and yet your headline makes you think you're going to get to a D at the end? I don't understand it. And it's something that I've seen with this film. And that's not me getting defensive for it. I just don't understand it. I don't understand the logic. And I can't even speak to whether or not that's consistent with some of the reviewers in question. I just noticed it with this film. And that might be the defensive DC fan going, oh, they're at it again. But 96 million isn't far off from the number that they're touting. You know, they wanted to be at 110. So, you know, we as fans can really be that viral word of mouth of getting people to go see this, you know, because you liked it. Don't, if you didn't like the movie, if you're listening to this and going, guys, you're nuts, this isn't my movie, fine, don't, you know, I'm not asking you to promote something you don't like, but I'm sure there's a number of people nodding and listening to this to fall in the, you know, in the same place as either you or me, really want this movie to be a success. This is, to me, if I'm looking at the movies that they were talking about in the series, this is like Wonder Woman in the sense that, for me, this is the right direction. This is what I want out of DC movies. I want them with this kind of feel, this kind of vibe. I want that sense of these being heroes and ones that I can follow. I want that moment where I'm looking at the screen and it is a GoPro looking at Henry Cavill interviewing him. And I'm like, I want to be that kid. That's what I want from these films. So they did really so much good in this movie. Help people to go see this, you know, that really should. If you have friends that you know that like traditionally like them, but maybe are down on DC films because they've been burned on some of them before, you know, as far as it wasn't their cup of tea, let them know this one's different, because it is. I genuinely feel this is different. I feel this is, especially people that like Wonder Woman. I think if you liked Wonder Woman, you like this.
Oh, definitely. I 100% will agree with that statement. And I agree with, you know, basically everything you've been saying, that this is a good movie. You know, I've been recommending it to people to go see it. I'm not just being the fanboy. I'm honestly and truly, I absolutely love this movie. You know, I've seen it twice already, and there would have been a third time if I could have fit it in. You know, if we weren't recording today, right now, I'd be in the movie theater.
I would
too. Watching it a third time. 100%. I'm looking probably Monday or maybe Tuesday after work. I'm going to see if I can figure out, because I do want to see this in IMAX. You know, I'm trying to figure out a way I can do that. So there's going to be a couple more viewings in a movie theater by me, you know, before this meets its end. And then I'll own this movie. I already know I'm going to own this movie. So this is really deep love for this movie.
I pre-ordered it already.
Yeah.
It's on iTunes. You can pre-order it now. Okay. Yeah. So I went and pre-ordered it. I mean, and I, without hesitation, like, that's a sign, though, because I, now, being fair, do I typically pre-order most superhero movies? Yes. But I kind of wait in most cases. You know, this has fallen into the Wonder Woman, Guardians of the Galaxy category where, like, I want to make sure it's pre-ordered because I want to receive that email. Because iTunes will send you an email when your pre-order's live. And I love that this, you know, I pre-order it, get going on it. I'm super excited for this. I grabbed the soundtrack to it because I thought the soundtrack was really good. I liked everything about this. So it's a great movie. And so I really do think the onus is on us as fans. If you love something, promote it. And I think if, you know, we can go viral and, you know, send the studios a message that, listen, we'll get behind your movies universally when you're doing stuff like this. I mean, yeah, we've certainly done podcasts on the other two, but we knew Batman v Superman in that podcast to the point of what I said earlier. We were offering a differing opinion on it. So it's not one where you can go and look at it and go, well, geez, you're going to rally your audience behind it. This one, I have no problem saying what wasn't fun about this. And friends of mine who didn't care for some of the darker installments really have liked this so far. So this really is the time to get this out there and send a message because we want DC to be heading in this direction. And I firmly want more of this. This, to your point, I want to see it too. We don't have an IMAX close that does first run movies though, do we?
Well, Cracker Park.
Well, they have an IMAX there?
Yeah.
Sweet.
But they're limited on what they run and when they run it though, for some odd reason. So that's why I was trying to get the timing.
Yeah. To see if it's available there. Cause I would love to see this in IMAX as well. Yeah. And it would certainly be the one. Well, it doesn't tell me if it's, I'm actually looking there now. This is going to be a thing to do during podcasts. Hey, let's pause while Sean goes and looks for a movie. I really do. I actually want to see this again in the same way you're talking about that one. So, oh, it is on IMAX there.
Yeah.
So yes, I would go see it in IMAX there. They have a 4 and a 7. Yeah, that's great. I like the runtime of this one. Like, I didn't feel like it was too long. That's another thing we didn't really talk about because it's a 2-hour movie. But I honestly, I didn't feel like I was wanting more at the end. And let me clarify that. I always want more. I want more footage and things like that. But I didn't feel like they rushed through anything. And I didn't feel like they went too long on anything.
Yeah.
Yeah, I felt like the pacing was really solid. You know what? So I want to clarify that because I was saying disjointed's not the right word. And I said that earlier, that it's not the right word. I don't know what I'm looking for. Choppy's not the right word either. There were just some things from a film standpoint you're looking at and kind of going, okay, I can see, you know, there were some reshoots and things. I can see where that came through. But that's nitpicky nonsense. In the end, the pacing of this film was really solid. And I really felt like it was a fast-moving 2 hours.
Hey, I'll tell you, my first watching, I didn't realize the 2 hours had come up by the end.
Yeah,
I honestly was like, wow, they're doing this is, you know, because when they were going into when they're leaving for the big final battle, I'm like, wait, this is the final battle, isn't this? And I'm like, holy crap, how long it's already been this long. And it really did catch me that, you know, I didn't realize how much of the movie had gone through and how much, you know, time we were, you know, and it was one of those things where it just kept going boom, 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 boom. They kept that nice pace going. Yes. Even when they were just doing the dialogue, they still were, they kept moving through. There was no, you know, moments where it was like, okay, let's get on to the next scene. I never had that, you know, throughout this. That was one of the things about this, the pacing, the speed, the timing, the blend of action versus dialogue versus, you know, the transitions between the two. Film wise, I had no complaints on that. I thought that was just an absolute nice fluid, you know, flow through.
Yeah. Yeah. That's absolutely, we're in complete agreement with this. Yeah. This was fun. It was just really fun. So I'm glad we got a chance to talk about this.
Carter Hall, scientific genius from a far-off world, flies into action as Hawkman.
I would like to remind everyone about our show voicemail line. It's 1-440-388-4434. or Dr. Norge on Skype. We love having you part of the show. Please feel free to call us in with your comments on anything we discussed today or anything going on in DC Comics in general. Remember, our email address is ragingbullets@gmail.com. If you'd like to send an email to get on the show, you're more than welcome to do that as well. Ragingbullets.com is our show website. That's where you'll find information on where the show is headed. It feeds into Twitter. It feeds to our Facebook fan page. We also are part of a wonderful Facebook group community. So please follow the show links to that. Join that group. The whole crew over there is just an amazing group of people. Constantly talking about comic and pop culture chat. And it's a safe place, positive people who really just enjoy these hobbies like you do. Over at Google, you can find us on Google+. We're on the PlayStation Network. I'm Raging_Bullets, your sensei underscore whatnot, Jim. We love gaming with all of you, so please feel free to join us there. I am on the Nintendo Network as well. I have no idea how to tell you to find me there, but feel free to email me at ragingbullets@gmail.com, and I'm happy to link up with you. I'm on the Miitomo app, and I think people have found me on that somehow. I'm marveling at you. And I'm loving the Nintendo Network, so feel free to add me on there as well. So we are sponsored this episode, of course, by DCB Service and InStockTrades.com. Jim, what's going on at DCBService.com?
Of course, we got our bundles, 50% off the different selected one-shop shopping really makes things easy, but also 50% off, we have Superman, Celebration of 75 Years hardcover, 50% off only $19.99. Superman Action Comics Deluxe Edition hardcover, The Mr. Oz Story, again, 50% off only $14.99, as well as a really cool Superman Action Comics Deluxe hardcover book 2, also 50% off only $17.49, so thank you, thank you, thank you, DCBS.
Over at InStockTrades.com, one of the deals of the week is 50% off the Justice League of America Rebirth Deluxe Collection hardcover. 50% off, only $17.49. As I mentioned earlier in the episode, they have the Flash Trade Paperback Volume 4 running scared, 45% off, only $8.24. I guess he can run squared too if he wants to.
Yes.
And because he's the Flash, just let him do his thing. Wonder Woman, the Legends of Wonder Woman, Origins Trade Paperbacks, 45% off, only $10.99. And the Wonder Woman Trade Paperback Volume 4, God Watch. This is, again, the Rebirth Series, 45% off, only $9.34. Whether you're running scared or running squared, go to InStockTrades.com to check out all of your collected edition needs. And I do want to thank both of those websites, DCBService.com and InStockTrades.com, for supporting our show and so many other podcasts. Mr. Segulin, our next episode, we're going to be talking comics, 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 and we will be actually posting what our topics are going to be up on the show website soon. So we're excited to be back and chatting comic books. So we will see you then.
Bye.
Strategery. What is that supposed to mean? That's a word that I have never seen. Do you exist? Strategery. Suddenly, I don't feel as smart as I used to be. I couldn't find it in a dictionary. Oh, what the heck is strategery? Why I need to know, I don't know. It's just my way. I asked a friend I know, and they told me go away. Strategery. Maybe it's something that is wrong with me. I may need a pill from the pharmacy. Maybe that will cure my strategery. Need to know, I don't know, it's just my way. Just because I don't know, I'll just say it anyway. Strategery. A definition isn't meant to be, or at least one that I can see. I'm so confused.